Good morning. Welcome to worship at St. Luke Lutheran Church. My name is Pastor Steve Brown, and we are so thankful that you are together with us. We're all together in worship. Today we are concluding a sermon series titled Peacemaker. Well, if you had known me back in the 1980s, in my early 20s, you might have called me a peacenik. That might be, not be a term that many people are familiar with, but that's what we used back then. Because I was involved with movements to try to make peace in the world, to move away from war. It was very important to me then, still is, frankly, but that's what I was doing. During that time, I was working at Luther Memorial Camp, and as part of my passion to make peace, I developed a lesson for students, middle school students, on peacemaking. I worked very hard in crafting it exactly how I thought it'd have the most impact. And so the first time I led this lesson, I was excited, and it began with this question. Who is your enemy? Now remember, that was back in the 1980s. And I was expecting, hoping they'd answer the Soviet Union. And that would then be a platform to go on to talk about making peace in the world with our enemies. Well, that's not what they said. They said, my enemy is my brother or my sister or my friend or neighbor or teammate or my dog. One kid said his turtle was his enemy. And I was caught off guard. And I said, okay, well, who's our enemy? Well, this group that I was teaching all happened to be from the same school district. And so they said, the rival school district, the rival sports teams. And I thought to myself, this is going nowhere. This is not where I had hoped it would go. And I had to kind of readjust. And so finally I just said, well, who's the enemy of the United States? And there was silence, confusion on their faces. Finally, one of the kids says, well, I've heard something about the Soviet Union. Those students taught me something, as students so often have over the years. They taught me this. That peacemaking begins up close in our primary and personal relationships as we work to resolve the conflicts that we have with our family, our relatives, our acquaintances, our neighbors, our coworkers, those that we're in a personal relationship with. So as we conclude this series on peacemaking, let's ask the question, how do you make peace up close? I invite you now to join in our worship.
Father God, we come to you this morning and we sing praises with every ounce of breath we have because you are good. In the darkness, we were waiting without hope. So from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes, to fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt. stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death, and the devils from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored, and the Church of Christ was born.
I have a question for you. Have you ever overreacted to what you perceive someone did that hurt you? I know I've done that far too many times. Someone says or does something and I overreact. And in retrospect, as I look back and I think to myself, what they did was relatively minor, but I overreacted. Have you ever done that yourself? Maybe you've been the target of someone overreacting. I know that's happened to me as well. Whenever that happens, I ask myself, what's really going on here? Because likely it's not whatever it is that triggered the overreaction. It's something else in my life. Something in possibly one of my personal and primary relationships where there's an unresolved conflict. Or something else in my life, and I'm kind of bringing that forward and projecting that onto this particular situation and overreacting. Our ability to be effective peacekeepers and peacemakers starts up close in our personal and primary relationships. When we work to effectively resolve the conflicts that we have in those relationships, we begin to be a peacekeeper and peacemaker. And it all begins with this simple question. What do I want most? What do I want most? You see, we may think when we're in conflict with someone that what we want most is to prove them wrong. That what we want most is to have them suffer a little bit for the perceived suffering that we think they've caused us. For what we think that we want most is for them to look bad. For them to be humbled. We think that's what we want. But if we're in a personal and primary relationship, and we want that relationship to continue and to be vital in our lives, to have peace in that relationship, we have to pause and say, what do I really want most? I may think that I want these other things, you know, to be proven right or to get back at them, some type of revenge. But really what I want most is for that there to be authentic reconciliation. And in fact, when that happens, when the conflict is resolved, there's greater intimacy, there's more depth, there's a deeper closeness, there's a longer sense of the strength of that relationship going on longer. That's what we want most. When we ask ourselves, what do I want most? We're really asking, saying, start with your heart. Start with your heart. What's in your heart that you want most? Peacemaking has always been and will always be a heart issue. And because of that, it's a spiritual issue. And therefore, the Bible speaks to the heart issue. For example, in the ancient Hebrew book of wisdom that's called Proverbs, that's in our Old Testament, here's how it addresses the issue of peacemaking being a heart issue. It says this: deceit fills hearts that are plotting evil. Joy fills hearts that are planning peace. Now that may seem like a little extreme, but it's true. Deceit here means lying or malice. When we are thinking in our mind, scheming in our mind, fantasizing in our mind how we will get back at someone, or we'll prove someone wrong, or we'll have someone suffer because of what we've suffered from what we think from them, that's what this verse is addressing. And we know that that doesn't in any way really lead to peace in our lives. If it comes about that we get retribution in some way, it doesn't leave us with a deeper sense of peace. It certainly doesn't leave peace in that relationship. It only makes more turmoil, more conflict in our hearts. Peacemaking up close starts when we ask the question, what do I want most? What do I want in my heart? And that's why it's a spiritual issue. Because if you are an authentic follower of Jesus, then Jesus is in your heart, and what you then want most is what Jesus wants most. So we ask the question, when it comes to responding to a conflict that we're having in our up-close relationships, what does Jesus want most? If Jesus is in our heart, that's what we want, what Jesus wants most. We're going to listen to some passages from the Bible where we're going to hear that passage from Proverbs, the ancient wisdom of ancient Hebrew scriptures. We're going to hear from the Apostle Paul, his writings, and we're going to hear some teachings of Jesus. And as you listen to this, think about what your answer is. What does Jesus want most when it comes to resolving conflicts in our up-close relationships?
Good morning. We have three readings from Scripture today. The first is from the book of Proverbs, chapter 12, verses 17 through 20. An honest witness tells the truth, but a false witness tells lies. The words of the reckless pierce like swords, but the tongue of the wise brings healing. Truthful lips endure forever, but a lying tongue lasts only a moment. Deceit is in the hearts of those who plot evil, but those who promote peace have joy. The second reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 4 through 7, familiar words about love. Love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. And lastly, the gospel lesson is from Matthew's gospel, chapter 18, verses 15 through 17. And hear these words from Jesus as the way they're intended. Jesus' way of resolving conflict. These are Jesus' words to us. As if your brother or sister sins, go and point out their fault just between the two of you. If they listen to you, you've won them over. But if they will not listen, take one or two others along so that every matter may be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. If they still refuse to listen, tell it to the church. And if they refuse to listen even to the church, treat them as you would a pagan or a tax collector. Here ends the readings.
So if Jesus is in your heart, he is on the throne of your heart, the throne of your life, then the love of Jesus is in you. And if the love of Jesus is in you, then this is the kind of love that's in you, that the Apostle Paul, in his letter to the Corinthians, articulates it in such a poetic way. That love is patient and kind. In other words, it doesn't rush to judgment. It doesn't rush to get revenge. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. The love of Jesus that's in you does not dishonor others. In other words, it refrains from trying to make others look bad or be dishonored in our desire to get back at them because of a conflict we have. It is not self-seeking. In other words, it cares more for what's going on in the other person's life, the person that you're in conflict with, than what you're experiencing. It is not easily angered. When the love of Jesus is in us, what we want most leads us to not overreact to something that's happened to us. The love of Jesus in us keeps no record of wrongs. That one phrase says so much. Because I don't know about you, but when I feel I've been wrong, when I'm in conflict with someone, when I'm in disagreement with someone, I'm starting to keep record of wrongs. I'm starting to imagine how I will prove to them the error of their ways. When the love of Jesus is in you, you don't do that because that's not what you want most. If the love of Jesus is in you, then you do not delight in evil, but you rejoice in the truth. Anytime there's a conflict that we have, we forget that we have our truth. We have our way of seeing it. We have our perception. But the other person or the other group also has their truth and their perception. And if the love of Jesus is in us, what we want most is to learn what their truth is, because we love the truth. It rejoices in the truth. If the love of Jesus is in us, it always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. In other words, we don't give up. What the Apostle Paul is teaching us, if the love of Christ is in us, if Jesus is in our heart, what we want most, if we start with our heart, is to bring authentic reconciliation between us and those with whom we are in conflict. Moving to the gospel lesson. This progression for resolving conflicts within the church, the body of Christ, the followers of Jesus, is well noted. And you'll find books and teachings written about follow these steps. But here's what I see so often happen. We move quickly to the last couple steps where we bring the matter to the church. We may do that officially or more often do it through gossip, harmful gossip. And then we treat them, as Jesus says, like a tax collector if they don't listen to the church. Forgetting the irony here, how did Jesus treat tax collectors? Those are the people he hung out with and befriended and accepted. People like Zacchaeus. And we so easily skip over the first couple steps in this conflict resolution process, which is to go privately to the person. And if that doesn't resolve the issue, do you get other couple people that we trust, that we both trust, so they can look at it objectively? That's what that means. The whole point of the process is not to exact retribution or to prove the other person wrong, so much as to bring authentic reconciliation. That's what Jesus wants. If Jesus is in our heart, what we want most is what Jesus wants most, which is to bring true resolution and reconciliation, to make peace with those people in our lives that we are in relationship with, that are up close and personal. So how do we do that? How do we do that? What are the practical things we can learn about how to resolve those conflicts? I have a book here called Crucial Conversations. Tools for Talking When Stakes Are High, written by four people whose last names are Patterson, Grenny, McMillan, and Schweitzer. This is by far the best teaching, the best book I've ever read on resolving conflicts. Many of you may have come in contact with this through a program called Vital Smarts. I know it's been used in a number of corporations, in a number of settings, so as to create greater organizational health in the relationships. If you know me, if you've read a book through with me or done a Bible study with me, you know that I read books very slowly and very carefully. And so I'm very unlikely to read a book more than once. I've read this book four times in one form or another because I find it so helpful. My wife has read this book. We've read this book and gone through it on our staff here at church. This book, I believe, is the most helpful resource for learning how to practically bring peace up close in our personal relationships. Now, I'm not going to have time to go through all that this book teaches today, but I encourage you to get it. But this book helped me to understand when it is that we need to have a crucial conversation, when we need to make peace. It helped me to understand how we make that conversation safe and how to avoid what's called the fool's choice, thinking that we either have to choose between speaking our truth or keeping the peace, that instead we can find that elusive and, that we can both speak our truth and keep the peace. How to create this pool of meaning in which we can have conversation where we're each putting our truth into that pool so we can understand it and it's done in a safe way. And that's all there. And I encourage you to get the book and go through it. I want to just spend some time, a little more time, on just one aspect, one key teaching in this book that I think especially speaks to the whole movement to make peace, to be a peacemaker. And it's called The Path to Action. Here's how it works. We see and hear someone do something. And what they do offends us, or we disagree with, or we perceive it's an attack on us. It hurts us. And that's objective. If there was a video camera, it'd say, yes, that's what they said, that's what they heard. But then we tell a story. In other words, we assign intention to what they did. We see or hear them do something, and we tell a story about why they did it. What was their intention? And most often, when we're in conflict with someone, we tell a story that makes them look bad, that appears that they have an evil intention or a malicious intention or an intention to hurt us. Or they don't care. For example, it's Valentine's Day. So let me use the example of a marriage. A wife sees and hears a husband do something, and it's hurtful to her. Maybe she feels ignored. And she adds a story like, he cares more about his job than about our relationship. Or in a friendship, we see and hear a friend do something, and we say, well, they really are out to make me look bad. In the recent political season we've been through, I saw this happen over and over again, where one side would assign attention or tell a story about what the other side is really intending. Well, when you tell a story that's malicious, you're going to end up with a feeling. And this is when the commandment, the Ten Commandments, the Eighth Commandment, you shall not bear false witness against your neighbor, really is helpful. Because if we tell a story that makes the other person look bad or doesn't explain their actions well, we're going to end up with a feeling. We're going to be mad. We're going to be sad. We're going to be scared because we have this story we've told about their intention being malicious in some way. And when we have those kinds of feelings, well, that moves us to act. And that person or that group that we're in conflict with sees and hears what we do. And they add their own story. And they have a feeling, and it just perpetuates itself. And it spirals down, not into peace, not into effectively resolving the conflict, but into greater conflict and greater turmoil, even a greater lack of peace. What we have to learn to do is to master our story. We're in charge of our story, the story we had. We choose what story we're going to add. We can't control this, but we can control the story we had. And the helpful, the peacemaking way to do that is to listen to what the other person is saying. What are they thinking and feeling? What was their real motivation for saying or doing the thing that we perceived hurt us? This is where the Eighth Commandment and Martin Luther's explanation of the Eighth Commandment is helpful. To not bear false witness against thy neighbor. Luther explains that in part that means that we are to explain our neighbor's actions in the kindest or most constructive way. You see, if we really learn the story behind their action, instead of having feelings of anger or hurt or fear, we might have feelings of compassion, of empathy, as we understand what it is that moved them there. And that's going to create another action on our part that's, instead of spiraling down into greater conflict, is going to move towards true reconciliation and peace. And it's going to deepen that relationship. It's going to help that relationship to be more vital and to have peace in that relationship and therefore in our lives. And is that not what we want most? And that's certainly what Jesus wants most. Peacemaking begins up close in our personal and personal and primary relationships. And those who learn the skills, and it really is a skill to resolve those conflicts, are better able to help make peace in their lives. You see, all relationships, marriages, friendships, family relationships, succeed or fail based on our ability to resolve conflicts. Because when a conflict happens, if it's not resolved, it just lies there. And then another unresolved conflict on top of that, on top of that, on top of that, all the way up to the point where you say, I can't imagine spending another day with that person. That's how personal and primary relationships fall apart. But if we can learn the skills for resolving conflict that are contained, for example, in that book, that use understandings like this, then we can make peace in those primary relationships. And when we do that, we are better able to make peace, help bring peace in others. Imagine what it'll be like if we start learning how to resolve those conflicts in our primary relationships. That it'll bring peace to us. It'll bring peace to the person we're in conflict with. It'll create a more vital, healthy, enjoyable relationship. And we'll be better able then to help others who are in conflict with each other, including large groups of people, to bring peace in those relationships. And we become what Jesus says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they'll be called children of God. Imagine what it'll be like if we do what we want most, that we start with our heart and we do what Jesus wants most, to be peacemakers. Let's pray. Good and gracious God, we find ourselves often in conflicts, even with those people with whom we are in the closest and most intimate of relationships. We think about those relationships on this Valentine's Day. Help us to understand your wisdom, wisdom that's contained in your Holy Scriptures that we find in books like Crucial Conversations about how to resolve conflicts in a peacemaking way. And then, God, with what we learn in our personal primary relationships, help us then to use that, those skills, those abilities to help bring peace in our world. And in this way, bring change, the change that you want most, Jesus. Help us. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
A new day is dawning, and love is on the move. For all who are broken, life's breaking through. To the wounded and weary, you've had enough. Hope is not that far. Wherever we are, we shine like stars. Wherever we when we love one another, we light up the dark. Wherever we are, we shine like stars. Oh, we shine like stars. Oh, with one spark of kindness, the healing begins. Have been shattered, let them shine again. In the here and now, let compassion rise, let mercy come alive. Wherever we are, we shine like stars. Wherever we go, we will take your heart, carrying freedom, bringing your kingdom to all the world. When we love one another, we light up the dark. Wherever we are, we shine like stars that light the way, all burning like a flame. With every act of love, your kingdom comes. For in us you put your life. One was dead, is now like a city on a hill, we will shine. Wherever we are, we shine like stars. Ooh. Wherever we go, we'll take your heart. Oh, oh, wherever we are, we shine like stars. When we love one another, we light up the dark. Wherever we are, we're gonna shine like stars. We're gonna shine like stars. We will shine like stars.
All right, my friends, so let's take a few moments to pray together, and we are going to pray together. I'm going to pray petitions, and at the end of each petition, I invite you to respond as we join our voices together in prayer regardless of where we are, we're here together in this moment, and the Lord abides with us as he promises and hears and inclines himself to our prayers. So at the end of each petition, I will say, let us pray, and your response is, have mercy, O God. Guided by Christ, made known to the nations, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need. For the gospel proclaimed in word and deed, for communities of faith in Germany, India, New Guinea, Columbus, Gehenna, and all around the world, all who show the face of Christ throughout this world, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For those responsible for safety and protection, for first responders and security guards, for police officers, attorneys and advocates, civil servants, our president, our governor, members of the legislature and judges, that they witness to mercy and justice throughout the world. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For all who suffer this day, for Todd and Daniel Friend, Carl Kuspert, Brandon and Melissa, Joy Bowersox, Jody Christensen, Sandra and Jake DeLagrange, Jean Donahey, Linda Fiesel, Armedia Federer, Kate Klein, Sherry McCarter, Sandy Murphy, Sharon Napier Rocks, Earl Osborne, Margie Rachel, Autumn Regula and family, Doug Rose, Rhonda Savage, Hayden Skosnick, Mindy Sproul, Jenny Waddell, Tracy Wood. We pray, Lord, for the employment for David Cecil, for Joanna Mahoney's children and grandchildren. We give thanks, Lord, for John's birth, the birth for Meredith and Justin Miller. We pray for their continued health, for John as he moves into this world, for Meredith as she recovers from giving birth. We pray for the family and friends, for Todd and Jane Friend on the death, and for Daniel and Isaac on the death of their sons and brothers, Faishan and Joshua. For the family and friends of Kent McGowan, family and friends of Tim Moore, and the family and friends of Lois Williams. We pray that Christ, our healer, transform sickness into health, loneliness into companionship, bereavement into consolation, and suffering into peace. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For St. Luke, that we experience an increase of number that will best enable us to fulfill the end for which we have been chosen. Unity in our hearts that celebrate the abundant mercy and love we have received freely. Let us pray. Have mercy, O God. Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Gathered as one, let us pray the Lord's Prayer, the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. So the discipleship path for St. Luke is, we invite all of us on this path to learn God's love and worship, to live God's love in life groups, and unleash God's love to serve those around us, to meet the hopes and hurts of those around us. So here's your opportunity to do just that. So first, learn God's love and worship. Certainly Sunday mornings, you can always join us every Sunday. But this week, Lent begins with Ash Wednesday. And we have a pre-recorded Ash Wednesday service that will be available online on our website, stlukecolumbus.com. beginning at noon on Ash Wednesday. You can access that worship service anytime from noon onward. And if you want to pick up a worship kit, that is, it will have communion supplies, communion in there, as well as some ashes for imposition of ashes during that service, and a bulletin. Just go to our website and you can reserve one of those worship kits to worship with us on Ash Wednesday. If you'd like to come to St. Luke for imposition of ashes, we have a drive-through imposition of ashes at 1 o'clock from 1 to 2 and 5 to 6 here at St. Luke. Just come in one of those 2 hours and you can receive drive-through imposition of ashes. Live God's love in life groups. A lot of us have Zoom calls throughout the week. For the last year, we've had many, many countless Zoom calls. And let's be honest, a lot of Zoom calls are not what they're cracked up to be. They can be tedious and draining. But what if you could have a Zoom call that's one of the best experiences of your week? And you can by having a life group on Zoom, an online life group. And if you'd like to start your own life group, go to our website. You can find information about how to do just that. It's very, very simple. It's simple as getting a few of your friends together, inviting them to form a life group, and just simply letting us know that you've done so. And we also have a great resource for you, a free resource, kind of like Netflix for spiritual growth. It's called Right Now Media. And so if you've already taken advantage of that and looked at it, great. If you've not, you probably received, if you're on our email newsletter, a link that will take you to setting up your own free account with Right Now Media. It gives a whole bunch of resources for life groups, but also for individual study as well. So take a look at that and consider, if you're not already part of a life group, starting your own online life group. And lastly, to unleash God's love, we have two opportunities for that. The first is if you'd like to help us as an online worship host, during the worship service like this, we have a platform that maybe you're on right now that you can see who's worshiping with you. Well, we need some hosts for that. And so if you go to our homepage for our website, you can find more information about what that host responsibility is. But we'd appreciate if you could consider and maybe even volunteering to be an online worship host. And secondly, LSS food pantries throughout the month of February are continuing that Super Bowl of Caring. And we're contributing to that LSS food pantry here in Central Ohio by donating what they requested, that is personal hygiene items and non-perishable food items. So if you have a chance to pick those up while you're at the grocery store, you can bring them right to the church here during the week, during office hours, and you can leave them with us and we'll make sure they get to LSS food pantries. All right, my friends, those are the announcements. As we finish our worship together, before we sing our last song, receive the Lord's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Giving it all.
Friends, go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Have a great week.